And success as a living, breathing country song. The Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, next on TNN. Music is unashamedly emotional, because that's the life Lorrie Morgan has lived. It's been a roller coaster ride of ecstatic highs and heartbreaking lows.
I'm looking for something in
life. She has a lot of emotions to deal with because she's been touched by a lot of different, you know, things in her life. A lot of good and some bad, but definitely been touched by a lot of things.
Lorrie Morgan's multi-platinum success has come only after years of professional frustration and personal heartache. Two of her greatest inspirations, her father and her first true love, both country music legends, were taken from her tragically early.
My life has been up and down with romance and heartbreak and death. I am a living, breathing country song.
A child prodigy, a mother at 20, and a widow at 30. Lorrie Morgan knows all about singing from experience and doing things her way.
She sings with feeling, and her voice is almost like she's lived the song.
I'm looking for something in bed, like the one that I wore when I first turned his head.
She's meant to be a star. It's like you see her. When I saw her and first met her, I said, this girl's a star.
She wants to be different. She doesn't always want to do everything that everybody else does. She wants it to be her way. So she doesn't want to be the same as everybody.
In red.
Born Loretta Morgan in Nashville on June 27, 1959, Lorrie was immediately immersed in country music. Her father, a future Hall of Fame member, was George Morgan, famous for his song, Candy Kisses.
Her dad sang to her a lot when she was a little baby. He would rock her and sing to her. It was one of the best feelings that she had when she was a baby, and it stayed with her. The music stayed with her.
He would get his guitar, it seems like every evening at home, and he'd take it out on the side porch and sing these wonderful Irish songs and lullabies.
Lorrie was the youngest of five children in a very close-knit family. And even when her dad was touring on the road, the house was full of music.
I can remember being a very small child. My sister Candy and Beth and my cousin Karen and Sue Ann, they would all sit together and sing all kinds of like folk songs, like, gosh, what was it? When I was a little bitty baby, my mom would rock me in my cradle. We sang all the time. Music was a huge part of our lives.
It didn't take long for Lorrie to start craving the limelight.
I was 4 or 5 years old, and I can remember pantomiming to Petula Clark Records and the Beatles, and it was just, oh, it always made me feel better. Music always made me feel better.
Her older sister always had fun dressing her up. and fixing her hair and putting makeup on her, and she would come out in the living room and play like she was going to put on a show, and she would charge us to watch the show.
Not content with pantomiming, Lorrie began to write her own songs. By pure coincidence, she would always get creative inspiration just as it was her turn to help with the washing up.
After everybody was finished eating, we'd be sitting around talking, and Lorrie would get this, oh, she says, I've got an idea for a song, and she'd quick jump up from the table and take her guitar and go back to the bathroom to keep from doing dishes.
Yes, I would. Yes, I would.
Although all five Morgan children grew up in a musical household, it was Lorrie's talent that shone through.
Even at such a young age, she sang so perfect or so beautifully, you know, I mean, it just came natural. I mean, I can remember, you know, when we were real young, you know, when Lorrie first started singing, you know, thinking, you know, you're going to be a star someday, kid.
Lorrie's inspiration was her father, whom she idolized. George Morgan was a regular on Ralph Emery's morning radio show, and he often took young Lorrie along to sing with him.
He brought little Lorrie out, I guess, when Lorrie was about 9 years old to sing All I Want for Christmas Is My Two Front Teeth. I remember watching her work with her father. I thought she was excellent.
Also, George often took Lorrie backstage at the Grand Ole Opry, where he was a member and a regular performer. Lorrie grew up rubbing shoulders with the greatest names in country music.
As a little girl in a glamorous world, yes, it was very exciting and intriguing and all that, and very fantasy type for me.
I noticed what an intent child she was. She was not missing a thing, not one thing. She's always had her feet firmly on the ground, head on her shoulder. She knows what it's about. She looks at it as a business. She's never looked at it with a lot of stars in her eyes because she saw that growing up.
Lorrie learned a lot backstage at the Opry, but she was not nearly as keen to learn when it came to school.
She didn't really like school. She hated it when she first started. One day, a teacher came out to get her, and they was walking down the hall. She bit the teacher on the hand. I mean, she hated school so bad. She did not want to go to school.
Sensing that his daughter was not cut out for an academic career, George Morgan gently pushed Lorrie in a different direction. When she was 13, he suggested that she sing a song live on national radio during his set at the Grand Ole Opry.
I kept thinking, oh my God, I've got a stomach ache. I can't handle this. I'm shot. I was a nervous wreck. I looked at one pole in the audience and stood there and looked over at my dad, and he was just crying, and it was a very magical night.
There's a lot of child in her voice, but she was still good. She could hold the notes, sustain the notes, and they were very clear.
That night at the Opry was a turning point in Lorrie's life.
Definitely. She got that little bug right then, I think. Even if she was scared, she got the bug.
I thought from that point on, when I got the standing ovation, this is it. You know, this is what I want to do. And it's always going to be this easy.
Despite her bright beginning, though, Lorrie would find out soon enough that the music business would not be that easy, not by a long shot. The Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, returns in a moment on TNN.
Other country.
The Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, continues on TNN. Lorrie Morgan's debut at the Grand Ole Opry at the age of 13 was her stepping stone towards a career in music, a career she never stopped dreaming about.
She would dream about it and talk about it and
and I would listen. And she said, don't worry, you're going to be with me, and we're going to go have this great future, and I'm going to have this success.
Having already decided that music was her calling, remaining in high school became virtual torture for Lorrie.
I hated every aspect of school. I knew what I wanted to do. I wanted to play my guitar and sing in clubs, and I wanted to be a superstar. And I didn't care about the boundaries of West India. I didn't care.
Lorrie often cut classes, sometimes to go to a senior citizen's home to entertain the sick.
I mean, I was supposed to be in, you know, economics, and I'm over at the old folks' home singing. And I wouldn't trade nothing for it. I mean, it was an education, a different type of education.
At the age of 15, Lorrie was full of dreams about her future in music. But suddenly, her world fell apart. In 1975, her father, her idol, died after heart surgery. It was a crushing blow.
He meant the world to me. He was my life. I mean, I looked up to him in everything. The way he handled people, the way he was gentle with his children, the way he was loving with his wife, his sense of humor. Everything about him was perfect to me.
Just a few months after her father died, Lorrie wrote and recorded this tribute to him when she was 15.
I'd write a song for him, play my guitar and sing. Daddy would harmonize and all the bells would ring. There will never be another man like my dad. So I'm walking in Daddy's shadow.
After her father's death, Lorrie began singing in small clubs around Nashville. She was following her dream, but also thinking of her family.
At the age of 15, Lorrie felt, I think, an obligation to take over and get herself in a situation to help her family, so help support her mother.
With the added distractions, Lorrie needed her friend's help with her high school studies. A week before school ended, she had not even started on the accounting workbook she had to complete.
And she said, oh, Ruth, I don't know. I haven't had time to do it, you know. Of course, she was doing her toenails then. But I looked around and I saw six or eight girls in there, and I started ripping the pages out. And I started handing them out to everybody, about six or eight pages each. And I said, look, everybody take these home, work on them over the next couple days. Lori's got to get this done. She's not going to graduate. A few days later, everybody brought it back completed. We got her book put back together, and she turned it in and she graduated.
After graduating, Lorrie began her music career in earnest. But it was much harder than she had imagined that night she debuted at the Opry.
I worked every nightclub in Nashville and every hole in the wall in the United States. You'd get to the hotel room and maybe get to lay down for an hour and a half and get cleaned up and go rehearse with this god-awful house band that had no clue.
Lorrie often drove to concert dates with her mother to places as far away as Nebraska. The grind was so relentless that Lorrie was ready to call her agent and quit the business.
We had to drag all our stuff in the room, and we were both so tired. And we got up to the room, and Lorrie says, I'm calling Buddy Lee's office right now. I am quitting. This is it. I said, Lorrie, now you wait a minute. You'll feel better in the morning. Don't call anybody right now. And she didn't call him, and the next morning she was all revived and ready to go.
While on the road, Lorrie began a tempestuous romance with bass player Ron Gaddis. 2 days before her 21st birthday, Lorrie and Ron were married, and soon after had a daughter, Morgan. But all of this was too much pressure for two young people trying to build careers in music.
It was a very destructive relationship for myself and him. We were both very young, and we parted, not at first as friends, but we ended up becoming very good friends. There's nothing in this world that I wouldn't do for Ron today, and I feel that he feels the same way.
Slowly, Lorrie began to make some headway with her career. In 1979, she was signed to her first record deal with the Hickory label and cut a single which had moderate success. Then she landed what seemed to be a prize job, touring with legendary singer George Jones. Lorrie sang the same duet parts made famous by George's former wife, Tammy Wynette, one of Lorrie's idols. Touring with George was an unforgettable experience, but not the kind Lorrie was expecting.
This was in his very bad days of drugs and alcohol and things like that, and I felt sorry for him, and it was affecting me mentally. I kept thinking, God, if this is what country music business does to you, I think I'm gonna get out, and I did.
Lorrie quit touring and stayed mainly in Nashville to raise her daughter. In 1983, she was hired as a regular performer on Ralph Emery's television show, Nashville Now.
From Music City, USA.
It's always a pleasure for me to bring you this bit of beauty. She's one of our regulars. Here is Miss Lorrie Morgan.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman. Given all you love to just one man.
Her television appearances made Lorrie a recognizable face in country music, but it seemed to bring her no closer to her goal of winning a deal with a major record label. To Nashville record executives, Lorrie's face was almost too familiar.
They saw you so often that you had a hard time getting their attention. It was just, you were almost like part of the woodwork, part of the scenery in Nashville.
Went to every door in Music Row and knocked on every door and, you know, hey, can I sing for you? And no, we don't need another female right now. I had a few offers that, you know, that I would get signed if I did favors in return. And I said, I will never get to the top that way. So if I don't get to the top, at least I failed honestly.
Well, my dad always told me there'd be days like
this. Lorrie continued playing the small clubs, performing country standards, and in between, she took every chance she got to play at the Grand Ole Opry. In 1984, the Opry rewarded her perseverance by making her a member of the Opry.
And I'm very glad, and I know you are too. Ladies and gentlemen, George Morgan's daughter and the newest member of the Grand Ole Opry, Miss Lorrie Morgan.
Ago, this was just a dream. When I used to come out here with my dad and sit backstage and hope and pray that someday I'd be able to come out here and sing.
But although she was a member of the Opry, Lorrie was still having no luck with the major record labels.
And it's like, oh yeah, that's Lorrie. Yeah, she's really good. But they didn't. To me, looking at it, it's like, why doesn't somebody take her seriously here?
I'd listen to the demo, and it'd be absolutely wonderful. And she said, oh, they don't like it. Turn it down. I'm never going to make it. I don't know what I'm doing. I'm never going to make it.
While her recording career was stalled, Lorrie's personal life went into overdrive. In 1985, she met the singer Keith Whitley, and she was hooked immediately.
He was the first true love of my life. Keith was everything I thought that any girl would want, and especially me.
Lorrie Morgan's life and career were about to change forever. The Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, returns in a moment on TNN. In 1985, when Lorrie Morgan met Keith Whitley, his career was beginning to take off. His single, Miami, Miami, was racing up the charts, and he quickly became number one in Lorrie's heart.
She just fell in love. It was overwhelming. I think she was overwhelmed by it. You couldn't keep them apart.
But Lorrie soon discovered there was a dark side to Keith. He occasionally went on depressive drinking binges that he could not control. But instead of leaving Keith, Lorrie vowed to try to save him.
I always felt she thought that she could help him. She wanted to help him so bad because she loved him so much.
Despite warnings from some, Lorrie married Keith in November 1986. In 1987, Keith and Lorrie had a son, Jesse. During the often long periods that Keith was not drinking, Lorrie says he was a wonderful husband and father.
When he wasn't drinking, he was the most romantic, gentle man I'd ever been with in my life, and I didn't want to give that up. And I thought we could correct the problem.
Jesse's birth marked the beginning of a very happy time for Lorrie. Her marriage and her baby were both new, and Keith was having nationwide success with a string of hit songs. Things looked so rosy that she was happy to put her own career on the back burner.
I was very content to do the Opry and to stay home with the kids. I was very content with that. The biggest part of my life was making his favorite meal and taking care of the kids and taking care of the house.
Although Lorrie was content at home, Keith urged her to push ahead with her career, calling Lorrie his favorite singer in the world.
He made her feel that she was a great singer. Maybe deep down inside, she needed that encouragement from a man and someone who she respected.
Keith started pestering his own record label, RCA, to bring Lorrie into the studio and to sign her up.
It really was being around Keith and Keith saying, she can sing, you should hear her sing, you should hear her sing, and that was how it all began. As she got into making the record, you know, everybody went around and, God, I didn't know she could sing that way.
The result was instant success. In 1989, after years of frustration, Lorrie at last had a hit record, Trainwreck of Emotion.
I can see tomorrow's headlines, heartbroken, blind devotion.
She knew exactly what her voice would do. She knew exactly what she was able to do. And she knew how to deliver a song. So she was a natural.
Lorrie followed up with another hit single, Dear Me, and a successful first album, Leave the Light On. She was finally on her way.
I kept asking him if he put garlic in it, and he said no.
Success usually has its price. In Lorrie's case, she was juggling two careers, one as a performer and one as a wife and mother, but she was determined to manage both.
The singing was so deep into her that she was so deep into it that she couldn't afford to give it up, because her whole life up to this point, that's all it was.
Keith had pushed for Lorrie's success, but now he began to feel pressure about Lorrie being on the road a lot.
He was afraid that he was going to lose her. She might get to the point where she was going to get too big to be dependent on him. And I think he wanted that. He wanted her to be dependent on him.
Keith's drinking, always a shadow on the marriage, began to get worse, leaving Lorrie in a constant state of fear about his well-being.
Well, I had to get rid of everything in the house that was, that had any kind of alcohol in it. From mouthwash to hairspray, cough medicines, anything that had alcohol in it.
Lorrie didn't trust Keith in the middle of the night not to get up and go find a drink. So she would tie their legs together so that if he got out of bed, he'd be dragging her.
Frequent trips to alcohol treatment centers did not work for Keith, and Lorrie became increasingly torn between the need to be on the road promoting her own career and the need she felt to be around Keith to protect him from himself. In 1989, the crisis became a matter of life or death. The Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, returns in a moment on TNN. And the Platinum Series continues on TNN. As Lorrie's career began to take off, her husband, Keith Whitley, began to drink more heavily. And Lorrie was torn between keeping her own tour dates and staying in Nashville to give Keith emotional support. A crunch point came in May that year, when Keith went on a drinking spree just before Lorrie was scheduled to go on the road.
I didn't want to go. I did not want to go.
We had the conversation between us, you've got to go. You know, it's just going to continue to happen this way, and you're always going to keep putting it on hold, because she had done that before. She had put it on hold, and we'd have moved everything back.
That's what bothers me about this business. It's not about your health or the way you feel, or someone might be dying from a heartache or you need some time. That doesn't matter. You got to get out there and promote this. You got to go. Well, this was my life here. You know, my husband, I knew something was wrong. And I was still too young. I was being bullied around. They said, you go, and I went.
2 days later, while on the road, Lorrie received a phone call from Nashville. Keith had gone on a massive drinking binge at their home and died from an alcohol overdose. He was 34. Suddenly, Lorrie Morgan was a widow with two children and not yet 30 years old.
She wanted to die. She wanted to lay down and die. She really did. She was that devastated and that scared.
Making it even worse for Lorrie was the guilt she felt from having been out of town against her own instincts when Keith died.
I was accepting full responsibility. Full responsibility. Especially looking at Jesse. You know, had I stayed home, your dad would be alive. You know, you'd have a daddy. And Morgan. I could not cure Keith. And Keith is the only one who could cure himself. And he chose not to. And it's taken me a long time not to live with the guilt of that. But it was not my fault.
To keep some kind of sanity, Lorrie threw herself headlong into her music. The night after the funeral, Lorrie decided to keep a date to play at the Grand Ole Opry, to give herself something to focus on. For this, she received a lot of criticism.
It was unbelievable, the strength, the courage that took. She went there so she wouldn't fall apart. She went to music. She went to the Opry. She did what she had to do to survive. And it killed me that she was criticized for that, because nobody understood it.
In the weeks after Keith's death, Lorrie lost 17 pounds from stress. She realized that she was now the breadwinner for her family, and she had to push on with her career. What was once a choice had become a necessity.
the true value of that whole experience was. You know, she learned to go on with her life. She had her children to look forward to, and she's just not somebody that gives up.
Lorrie herself took strength from remembering how much Keith had loved her singing.
He was very sincere in his belief in me. And it made me feel like, well, he must see something, so I'm gonna be the best there is. I'm gonna be everything I can be.
And I hope God knows if he let you go, I'd never send you back. And if God forbid you leave this earth again while I see.
Dealing with Keith's death brought out the writer in Lorrie. She had a hit with her own song, If You Came Back From Heaven.
Oh, if you came back from heaven, would it be like it was then? Would we just pick up where we left off and try it all again? Oh, if you came back from heaven, it would freeze me in my tracks.
Facing life as a breadwinner for two children was a frightening prospect for Lorrie. But in rising to the challenge, she was about to become one of the biggest stars in country music.
I hope God knows if he let you go, I'd never send you
back. Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, returns in a moment on TNN. Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, continues on TNN. Lorrie Morgan began the 1990s with added pressure on her career, because as a recent widow with two children, she was now the family breadwinner. But there was little need for her to worry. A flood of hit records was soon incoming, including Watch Me, 5 Minutes, and Something in Red. Lorrie was on her way to selling more than 7 million records before the end of the decade, plus a string of awards. She's been named Female Artist of the Year 4 times at the TNN Music City News Awards, and has won Vocal Event of the Year from the Country Music Association. Lorrie quickly built a loyal following because many of her songs dealt with issues important to both Lorrie and her fans. The struggles of a modern woman to be strong and independent while also retaining her femininity.
Something in Red, which really talked about the life of a woman, having a baby with a man and dealing with relationships and still being attractive. And this really alerted women to the fact that Lorrie understood what it was like to fall in love and get married and gain weight and get up a little size bigger in clothing and still want to retain the romance in life. And I think that most working women identify with this.
What a strong woman Lorrie is. She represents women so well. The obstacles that she's been forced to overcome of divorce, single parenting, being a widow at such a young age, you know, this has not been an easy road for her.
I've been living with a heart on the mend, wondering how will I ever be strong. I know I'll live to love again. I just leaned on you.
No song better explained Lorrie's triumph over hardship than her hit, I Didn't Know My Own Strength.
I didn't know my own strength till I had to pick myself up and carry on without your love. I'm getting back on my feet. It's been a long, hard fall, but I'm after all, no, I didn't know my own strength.
1990s, it was not just Lorrie's songs that were making headlines, but also her love life. After Keith died, she felt she might remain a widow for life. But during a concert tour, she fell for Kenny Rogers. After they agreed to part as friends, Lorrie had a whirlwind romance with one of Clint Black's touring party, Brad Thompson. Before she knew it, she was married again. But soon the marriage was over as quickly as it had begun. Undaunted, however, Lorrie continued to look for Mr. Right, someone who could live up to her father's high standards.
I think he was every little girl's dream of what their dad should be and what you want to find in your husband, you know, that you want a man just like Daddy.
He would drive hundreds of miles just to come and just walk into their bedroom and tell them good night. He was just so attentive to them. That was a man to them and to her, and she thought every man should be like that to her. And they weren't.
Lorrie began a long-distance romance with the star of the Dallas Cowboys football team, Troy Aikman. She even talked of giving up her career to move to Dallas.
He had just swooned her over, and it was she was so in love that she, or blinded by love, that she was willing to throw it all away for him, you know, and I'm thinking, oh, I don't believe I would do that. I haven't met anybody yet that I would do that for.
After the pressures of distance ended her romance with Troy Aikman, Lorrie had another high-profile liaison with Tennessee actor and senator Fred Thompson. But again, career differences brought that to an end.
Her sisters and I used to laugh. We'd have a page this long of all the people she's dated, and we'd call each other on the phone. We'd say, uh-oh, we forgot somebody. And we'd have pages of people that she dated trying to find this right person. This real knight in shining armor that would carry her off on a white horse to the forever after, you know?
Lorrie's search took another turn in 1996. A duet led to romance and to a marriage that has brought her happiness once more. The Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, returns in a moment on TNN. The Life and Times of Lorrie Morgan, the Platinum Series, continues on TNN. After a string of ill-fated romances, Lorrie Morgan did find happiness again in 1996 when she recorded a duet with singer John Randall. The duet blossomed beyond the music, and not long afterward, Lorrie married for a fourth time. As something of a wedding present, their duet By My Side won Vocal Collaboration of the Year at the TNN Music City News Awards.
I have found happiness again, and I'm very content in my life. John's a wonderful man, and we've learned to laugh, and laughter is a great medicine for a lot of things.
With all her concert and recording dates, Lorrie's career seems to move at 100 miles an hour. That makes her family in Nashville doubly important to her when she's home.
She'll make the decisions on what we're going to do for Christmas or what we're going to do for Thanksgiving, and let's see what Lorrie wants to do about gifts. And she likes to make decisions.
Although Lorrie's been in the entertainment business for almost her whole life, she continues to seek new challenges. She's branched out into acting with a starring role in the TV movie Proudheart.
So, what about you?
What about me?
Are you married?
I used to be.
You got kids?
I got a little girl, Rose. She's 10.
Yeah.
Acting is only one of several new directions she's exploring.
I want to direct videos. I want to produce records. Those are my two main challenges right now.
Meeting new challenges is nothing different for Lorrie. It's always been her nature.
When she was little, she was always ready to go play hard, you know, whether it's kickball or softball. Lori's very competitive. She'll go at it with you, you know, full bore.
Come on! Ah, safe.
One lifelong ambition that Lorrie recently fulfilled was to record an album of old love ballads called Secret Love. It's music she grew up hearing her father sing, and the album is, in part, a tribute to him.
He could sing everything from country to opera to, Dean Martin to Perry Como. There are times when I sing for him. There's those moments that I know he would be proud of.
Still hear me, we'll start all over again. Oh, and hear me, I hope you stay.
As Lorrie says, her life has had so many ups and downs that she sometimes feels like she's living inside a country song. All those experiences are brought to bear in her art. She sings with a realness that many other singers cannot duplicate.
She was born to do this. This is not really something that, you know, you take a graduate course and then you take, you know, another course on this. She does it every day and she learns from it and you can feel it.
Oh, and hear me, I hope you stay till the end. Yeah, they could see me now.
It's extremely important to me. It's always been important to me that country music, my music, be about realness. And that's meant more to me than anything.
Dear me.